And that number is at the bottom of your screen at 770-398-28. We would love to hear from you if you've got a praise report, prayer request, or just want to share something about the show. Or if you have a question for a guest and you want to call in, since this is a live show, we'd love to hear from you. So please use that number throughout the show. And again, we'd love to pray with you and hear from you.
You know, truly what you said reminds me, I mean, if you're not overcoming something in life, eventually you're not living. Right. I think that so many of the guests that we have had and interviewed over the last couple of years we've been here have been people who've just overcome amazing things.
Yeah, it's been
things.
Awesome.
And, you know, our next guest tonight is an amazing young man.
Yes.
It's no secret that in the last few years, the foster care system in certain states, and if not the whole system as a whole, has come under a lot of scrutiny, is what with children being literally lost in these systems. Mm-hmm. I mean, not like, oh, he's lost in the foster care. I mean, literally, we don't know where Johnny is. There's clearly something wrong with a system that is supposed to be better than the system that you, or the situation that you left. Right. And yet we're seeing there's so many failings in this system. And that's not to condemn the foster care system as a whole, because I know there are thousands and probably millions of children out there who owe their lives to loving families who take them in. But what happens in those failing situations? A situation where somebody literally brings a child into their home because of monetary reasons or for other reasons other than because it's the best for that child. And our guest, our first guest this evening, Jeremy Collier, is an excellent example of when things go wrong. He was abandoned by his parents at 10 years old, and he and his siblings found their way into the foster care system. And what you're going to hear from Jeremy himself is the erosion of care, how he went from a loving family to a bad situation to indeed a worse situation. And so this evening, I want you to just sit back and really listen to the story of a young man who overcame incredible odds to become very successful in what he's doing now. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to Jeremy Collier. Yeah,
welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Yes, thank you for being here.
Your story, chronicled in your book, Not a Statistic, is a survivor story. Mm-hmm. And my son is 13 years old, and I can't even imagine at 10 years old being faced with the situation that you found yourself in. Take us back to when you were 10 years old.
Or even younger.
Yeah, and how you ended up being in foster care.
I'd say it started, like, my parents, when we were younger, they kind of just lived the party lifestyle. And a lot of times I would either look to my older siblings to, like, take care of us, or we would just be fending for ourselves. And when my dad became out of the picture at one point, my mom was just taking care of us at a hotel. And at one night, continuing her lifestyle, she decided that she couldn't deal with it anymore by herself. So she just left in the middle of the night, and the way we found out is she gave us a call the next day and said, hey, you know, I won't be coming back, and we had to figure out what do we do for ourselves from there. And for a short amount of time, we lived with an aunt, but having a bunch of people in, like, a two-bedroom apartment didn't really work out, and she gave us over to the foster care system. And at first, you know, I was, you know, even though I knew the situation was bad and maybe wanted something different, but when you're thrown into a situation like that, like, you kind of, your body screams like no, because you don't want things to change. Like, you're just so used to it. But my first foster family was wonderful, and through them, I was able to find God and be able to, you know, become a really good Christian as I am today. But, like, when I was younger, I had known some church, but it was kind of like the wrong reasons. Like, the church I was in was, it was like centered towards kids, but it was more of, like, you know, giving them reasons to go to church, not showing them, like,
that relationship.
Yeah, the relationship with God. And
you know, and Jeremy, too, because I've read your book, because you sent it to us in advance, and I think that I was just so moved by how, when Rick said you're a survivor, you truly are, because even before 10, so for years, since your some of your youngest memories, right, you survived emotional, physical, and mental abuse quite extensive.
Yes.
Even from your parents, and then as far as well, like, some things that I have read to you where you were burned when you fell down, when you were, you know, was it third degree burns on your stomach?
Yes, it was. I actually fell on top of a kerosene heater. Oh. Luckily it had like a metal grate around it, but it still, you know, obviously gets really hot on that.
Right.
But and I was shirtless at the time, which probably helped a little bit, because the t-shirt could have been caused more damage. But
right. And even bullying in school and all kinds of things.
Growing up, I guess, you know, different situations, like I was more shy and everything, I guess. So I guess I was kind of a little susceptible to it just because, like, people saw me as different in a way. And I guess it just kind of made me a target for it.
Sure.
And, you know, going to deal with that and learning how to just kind of, like, brush it off really helped me out in the long run.
Right.
I think the amazing thing about your story is that a lot of times when we interview people, they say, you know, I had a relationship with God at a young age, but then this happened to me, and as a result, you know, I trashed my relationship with God, and it wasn't until I was in my 30s or 40s that I rediscovered him. And I think it's interesting that yours is literally the contralateral to that. It's the opposite. I was thrown in this horrible situation, and through God's grace, I found him, and that was what carried me through the next 18 years of hell, if you will.
One thing, like, I've met quite a few of my friends that have had that situation happen, and one thing I do is, like, just tell them, you know, take a step back and see, like, how is this changing you as a person and making you better in the long run, or maybe not overreacting to the situation and thinking that it's worse than what it is, and, you know, just taking the time, take a deep breath, and, you know, going through it, and then, you know, relying on God more instead of, you know, less, and you will see, like, where he's going to take you from there, and lead you to, you know, what he has for you in the future.
Yeah, that's what I like about you. And at the end of your chapters, it's kind of like you have a piece of, you know, like a nugget of wisdom. It's almost like you'd say that. So you've described in detail. So you take us through your life and your experiences. But then at the end of the chapter, you'll say, you know, like exactly what you said, you know, don't turn your back on God, or don't allow that to make you weaker, make you stronger. And truly, you've not felt sorry for yourself in these situations. You've allowed this to strengthen you. Because after that first loving, I thought that was very dramatic. I just want to say that about your mom. So your father was in jail after trying to shoot your aunt.
Yes.
And then your mother moves you into a hotel room. And most of your life, you slept on the floor. Most of your life, you did not even have a bed.
For the majority of my life with my real family, yes.
And then, right. And then your mother leaves one night to go drinking, which you're thinking she's going to come home, And then she calls and says, I'm not coming back.
Yep.
And so that's what thrust you into the foster care system after leaving with your aunt. And then this first family was really loving, though. But I thought it was interesting, as loving as they were, you were saying it was hard to kind of attach, right, as a family member. That's got to be hard.
Yeah, it was completely different than what we were used to, because you go from, like, almost no rules, or at least, you know, you're seeing them as a party family, and, like, just going out, and they only worry about themselves.
Sure.
But then my first foster family, there's more, you know, structure, but we just saw it as more rules and, you know, having to do what they say. But it was, in the long run, I was able to look back a little bit more and, you know, realize it was all for the best.
Sure.
But just in the first situation, it's like, wow, it's completely different. And, you know, like I said, your body kind of screams no because you're not used to it. But being able to, like I try to tell people, you know, especially in the foster care system, don't be afraid to, you know, let your guard down and embrace, you know, the people that care about you and are trying to show you, you know, how to have a relationship with God.
Exactly.
Well, you know, another amazing thing about you is with the story that you have, you know, I was fascinated reading your bio that you actually graduated with a bachelor's of business degree in finance and in business administration. And I think that's really amazing because, like I said, typically the trajectory path for someone who's gone through what you have is substance abuse, you know, being molested, you know, and a string of prison sentences and things like that. And so it's amazing. It must have been a tremendous self-drive to did you I guess what I'm saying is, and maybe for our viewers' benefit, did you just see yourself as saying, I'm gonna be better, I'm gonna be different?
I mean, even from before foster care and just as a child, I knew I wanted to embrace school. That was like maybe how I dealt with some things, like I just embraced, you know, doing homework, or just, you know, I loved that. Like, that was one thing I was good at and I was able to control. And but I know one thing, the reason I named my book Not a Statistic is because of the statistics that surround foster kids, and I believe only 3% of all of them go to college and graduate. And my last foster mom, she used to work with foster kids when she was younger, so she knew the statistics, and she automatically made the assumption that I would become that way. Despite how I was doing, you know, in my life, she just automatically assumed and put that on me herself. And that's from that point of her, like, literally saying, you're not going to be anything but a statistic on a wall. That kind of, you know, even pushed me even further. I was already wanting to go to college, but that just kind of gave me even more of a drive to show, you know, you don't have to be what, you know, somebody says about you, or that part of that demographic, or, you know, that group of people. It's not, that doesn't, isn't what defines
you. It doesn't define you.
I think that's a great takeaway message. Mm-hmm. So many people that I know on the other side of the lens there have grown up or are hearing now, you know, like I'm picturing like the battered wife who, you know, says it's never going to change for me. It's never going to be any different. Mm-hmm. And you're proof positive that that's not the case. It's in your head. It's not in your surroundings.
Exactly. I have a question for you that I believe will help our viewers who are hearing your story and who get your book and read it. How was it that you were able to forgive your parents mm-hmm. and those who hurt you?
I get that question kind of a lot, mm-hmm. like, you know, how do you still have a relationship? And I'd say it's by the grace of God, mm-hmm. and, you know, knowing that, you know, at that situation, they were, you know, on drugs and everything, which isn't their, it was obviously by choice, but, you know, I just know it doesn't feel right to just have right. the hate inside of me and to, you know, be able to release that and just like, mm-hmm. you know, let God's will, you know, work through me Amen. And maybe, you know, show that to them and hopefully, you know, be able to inspire them to give their lives to God.
I mean, Jeremy, so. This is huge. That's I hope you know what an accomplishment that is. Yeah. How old are you?
I'm 23.
To be so young, yeah. we see so many people who hold on to so many hurts from their childhood into their yeah. 50s, 60s, 70s, and they're just clinging to it like it's theirs. For you to be 23 years old and to say it by the grace of God, I mean, what a testimony. And I really hope that encourages you who are watching tonight to know that you can give these things to God. You can go through physical, emotional, mental, spiritual abuse, and you can still be healed and whole. And that brings me to my next question, because this is cool. Then how do you take all of that and become a published author to write Not a Statistic?
My fiance actually kind of pushed me to do it. I always wanted to write a book, and I wasn't sure what to do. Mm-hmm. And I knew, you know, my story, especially going, pushing past through high school, going through many different things, like being homeless at one time
wow.
and things like that, and then going and still graduating from college.
Mm-hmm.
I knew that I had to at least share my story, no matter if I just help one person or 1,000 people, as long as I could show somebody the way that, you know, just being dedicated, you can, you know, become more than the statistic.
Right.
And, you know, be successful in whatever you choose to do in life.
Right.
So obviously you're a driven young man. I guess the question that has been kind of haunting inside of me for the whole interview is, what's next for Jeremy? What do you see yourself doing next?
Other than just the book, I just want to live to, you know, inspire others to do mm-hmm. better than what they've been told they are, or just to, you know, strive to better themselves and to succeed in whatever you want to, you know, just never letting go of your dreams and, you know, fighting mm-hmm. for it. Don't just, you know, hope that it falls in your lap. You have to, you
That's
know,
right.
go out there and you have to, you know, take it.
Work.
And, you know, and just not only just through that about what you want, but what does God want for
yes.
you?
Yeah.
And being able to, you know, show that and, you know, live that way.
Amen.
So.
Well, this is only the beginning. I mean, this is just your first book. This can go in 1,000 different directions. This is a
yeah.
motivational talk right there.
Yeah.
This could be, you could speak to shelters, children in foster homes. I mean, because
yeah.
a portion of your book is going to, right, foster care or?
Yeah, there was actually an organization, a nonprofit organization that a foster parent started. It's called One Simple Wish.
Mm-hmm.
And they go around the United States granting wishes to kids in foster care. And even those who have are older and aged out but are still a part of it, and just to give them something that is theirs. Like, mm-hmm. you know, not all foster kids, they don't get to keep everything. Sometimes it's just packing things in a plastic bag and moving to the next home.
Okay.
And they want something that is theirs that they can keep and take from place to place, or just to help inspire them, say, if they want to take a class,
okay.
but they don't have the money to do it, they figure out a way to give them, you know, hope. And to give them something that they want and not just, you know, going from foster home to foster home and not having anything to look forward to.
Exactly.
So,
well, you know,
that's
one
awesome.
Of the things Tanya and I have felt from very early was the thing that bothers you the most is oftentimes where your purpose lays. Mm-hmm. And it seems like this is really something that bothers you as the condition of these kids and the ones that are, you know, coming up behind you. And, you know, it's commendable that, like I said, like she said, at 23 years old, you've put a horrific past mm-hmm. behind you and are channeling that into something
mm-hmm.
that no doubt is going to impact future generations. And we wish you the absolute best.
Really proud of you.
In the last 30 seconds we have, tell us how our guests can learn more about you and what you're currently doing.
Mm-hmm.
To learn more about me and just the book or what I hope to do with it,
mm-hmm.
I do have a website online, which is my name, jeremycollier.tateauthor.com. And it shows you know, what I want to do, like kind of gives you a brief description of what the book is about.
Mm-hmm.
and like how I want to use it in the future to help others, whether you've been in foster care or not, even just in general,
right,
to help others that are going through a rough time in any situation, and how to take that and overcome it to achieve your dreams.
Amazing. Thank
you
so much.
You're an amazing young man,
here.
And yes. Clearly not a statistic.
Not a statistic, yeah.
We very much appreciate you coming here tonight, and we hope that some of our viewers out there are truly inspired by Jeremy's story, mm-hmm, and what he's offered. And do check out his website,
yes,
and learn more about how he can, how his story can inspire,
yes,
you and just encourage you to overcome the challenges that you face.
That's
every
right.
Day.
And on our Facebook page, you know that you can check out Atlanta Live on Facebook, but also Boundless Limits, because we care so much about our guests and we care about you connecting with them. We know how busy you are. So on our Boundless Limits page under Hosting Atlanta Live, we have a photo album, and we'll have his book information and all of our guest information there for you and your family. And right now, we're going to have more music from Lisa Jackson. And she is singing We Worship You.